Excellent to be back. We had a good trip, good vacation. We drove to North Carolina, drove back to New York City, sat for 2 hours in DC on 95. I told you it's the worst. Then we flew to London. We flew back here Friday night. We got back in here late. So we're still a little bit jet lagged, but we're good and we're healthy. It was a good, restful time away. Good time with physical family, but I'm very glad to be back with my spiritual family back home with you guys. I really do start to miss you guys while we're away. So thank you for being a church that cares about your pastor and his family. Thank you for giving us time. Thank you for expecting us to take that time. We feel very loved and taken care of. We're very glad to be back and ready to get back to work. And before I get some feedback, I did not forget to shave. I'm just trying something a little bit different here. I had 2 weeks off. It was my one chance. I've never had a beard before. So I'm just seeing what I can do. I don't know if I can really do an actual man beard. But just give me a week or two. It'll be gone. So don't let this distract you from the work. But yeah, my wife likes it, and her opinion matters more than you. So that's how it is. Now, listen, there are all kinds of things. I just want to sit here and talk to you for 45 minutes about our trip. I love traveling. My brother and his family, they live in London. And they were unable to come home for Christmas this year because they had a short break with their kids. So we called us up about 6 or 8 weeks ago and said, hey, can we fly you over to London? We're lonely. And we're like, yes. Yes, you may fly us over to London. Now, I love that city. You guys know that I'm a major New York City snob. I think it is the greatest city in the world. But if there is one city that can come close to rivaling New York City, then it is London. It's all the cool things about New York, and then you add 1,000 years of history. And so that's here. I really love London. But we had been there this was our third time. So we've been there a number of times. This was our first time with the girls. But since we had seen London so much, we thought, hey, we've never, been outside of London. So let's go, explore a little bit. So sermon illustrations coming up soon. We made the mistake of renting a car. I think my wife is still recovering from me driving a stick shift on the left side of the road in a new country. You'll hear about that later. But we just went and explored the English countryside. We got to go to a bunch of castles. We went to Canterbury Cathedral, which has been something on my list for a long time. It's the heart of much of the Christian world for like 1,000 years. We got to see some of that. We saw the English countryside. We got to go to the White Cliffs of Dover. It was just all beautiful. The Cliffs of Dover, I don't know if you know, they're 300 feet tall, just right over the water. It's the English Channel, and they're chalk, so they're white, and it's beautiful. When you step up and you look down, and just bam, it's just a long ways down. And on a clear day, which we actually had on one clear day, you can actually see France. It's about 20 miles away across the channel. You can see France in the distance, and man, Melissa's not a heights person. So we got there for a second, she's like, I think I'm good. And I just went running, just kind of along the heights. Just like, there's something about standing on the edge of a precipice and looking down, and just loved it. So it was just beautiful scenery, beautiful places. I love traveling. I absolutely love this world, and I love many of the things in this world. Which seemed to be a bit of trouble when I began to study our passage for today. Turn to 1 John chapter 2. We're going to be in verses 15 through 17, page 1021. And John is going to open up our passage saying, do not love the world. And then he keeps writing, if anyone does love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Trouble. I definitely love the world, as I just said. Here John says, do not love the world, or the love of God is not in you. And hold on, what about the verse, like the one verse that everybody knows? John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. That verse was also written by John, the same author. So we have God loved the world so much that he sent his son. And then here we have, do not love the world or the love of God is not in you. Confused. Well, if you are, good. My goal is to fix that here this morning. Remember where we are in 1 John. This is a letter that John wrote to a couple churches to help us know. John wrote this letter to show us how we could know that we know God. Lots of people claim to know God, but how can you test if you actually do? Well, 1 John is how. Remember, there are three tests in this book. You can know you're a Christian if you pass these three tests. The moral test, do you obey the commandments of God? social test, do you love the people of God? And the theological test, do you believe the right things about Jesus and love Him because of those right things? Those are the three main tests repeated in this book. But I'm going to argue that I think this is a sort of fourth mini test. Right? This is the worldly test. Do you love the world? Because if you do, according to John, the love of God is not in you. But hold on, before you can answer that question, we've got to try and figure out what exactly he means there by that word, world. But up front, I want you to see and feel how high the stakes are. Love the world, you can't love God. And if you don't love God, well, eternal separation and hell await. Right? Pretty high stakes. I hope you're a little bit nervous. I hope you're a little bit uncomfortable, because John here is about to drop the gauntlet. 3 weeks ago, last time we were in 1 John, John kind of took a step back from the test to encourage us. Remember, he is encouraging us who we are in Christ. Our sins are forgiven, we know the Father, we know the Son, and we have overcome the evil one. But now he's back to work. Now he's back to challenging us. Do you know God? Well, you can tell by your relationship with the world. And our goal this morning is simply to understand what the world is and what John means by and what worldliness is. And I want to lead us in the direction of loving the world a little bit less. Four questions for our outline this morning that I think will help us understand this passage. You've got it there in your bulletin. What is the world? What in the world is the world? What does it mean to love the world? Why is loving the world so bad? And how do we not love the world? All right, so that's kind of what we're going to follow as we work through these three verses. Let me read the text for you first. It's short, just three verses. 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. This is the reading of God's Word. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and the pride of life, is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. Bow with me, let's begin our time with a word of prayer. Father, I am very grateful to be home. I'm very grateful to be back. I'm grateful to have the privilege to stand here in front of your people, Father, and to proclaim your word. Father, it's a privilege that I never want to take lightly. It's a privilege that I am not equipped in and of myself to do. So, Father, I pray and ask your Holy Spirit to work here in this time, to work and speak through me, and to work in the hearts of everyone in here. Father, I pray that we would understand your word. I pray that we would understand what the world is, and I pray that you would pull back the curtain and show us just how the world is dying, how the world does not satisfy. Father, show us where it is that we are attached to and have great love for the world. And Father, break us from those attachments and just give us a great love and a superior love for your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, draw us to Him in this time. And we ask this in His name. Amen. All right, so the key to understanding this challenging passage is simply to understand what John means by world. And thankfully, that's not that difficult, because he tells us exactly what he means by world in verse 16. But I think it's safe to say that many of us grew up with a very specific and different understanding of worldliness. An understanding of world and worldliness, I think, that doesn't come from the Bible. And what that often does is it leads us to condemn things that the Bible doesn't condemn as worldly, and then it often leads us to fail to condemn what the Bible actually does condemn as worldly. If you're anything like me, you grew up in a context that defined the world and worldly things, mostly, it seemed, as cultural things that my parents didn't like, right? Worldliness was all about not doing certain things. So if you were worldly, you were worldly if you listened to any secular music. I remember, like, Christians having, like, secular music burning parties, where they'd bring all their terrible secular music and they would burn it in a bonfire, roast marshmallows. And you were worldly if you watched any movies. Christians didn't play cards and they didn't dance because those things were worldly. I remember really liking the game Spades and Hearts and once being like reprimanded for having these deck of cards from the devil. I'm like, hey, what? I just want to play Hearts. Like, it's on my computer. It's fun. Cards were worldly. Alcohol was worldly. Tattoos were worldly. It was worldly if men had earrings and long hair. It was worldly if women wore pants and had makeup on. And some of you are probably nodding along. Yeah, okay, that's all pretty worldly. But no, this is how we often think worldly. This is how fundamentalism has always defined world and worldly. But I want you to notice something, that not a single thing that I mentioned in that list is actually forbidden in the Bible. Not one of them. The Bible never gives us a list of specific cultural practices that we should avoid if we want to avoid the world. Because that's not what the Bible means when it says world and not loving the world. So what does it mean? Well, the difficulty lies in the fact that John uses this one word, world, cosmos, in the Greek, to refer to a number of different things. Three major ways that John uses this word. First, he uses world to refer to the physical creation, or to the universe. There's no way that can be how he is using the word here, because God created the world, and God created it good. Psalm 19 tells us that the heavens, the created order, declares to us God's glory. Romans 1 tells us that God reveals himself to us in the things that he has made. Creation is his, and it is good. So there's no way John here can mean that we are not to love the world in the sense of creation or the universe. No, you should love it very much. You should delight in it and enjoy it. When we moved up here 3 years ago to New York City, one of the first things we did when we had a free weekend or a couple of days was we drove out to Niagara Falls. I wanted to see it my entire life. From south, I'd never been north, never seen it, just saw pictures. So we made a long drive out there. We only stayed one night. We went to the American side, and we stared at the falls. We drove around to the Canadian side, and we stared at the falls. Then we rented a room on the Canadian side that just looked out over the falls. And I stood there in the window looking at the falls, because they were breathtaking, and they were beautiful, and they were amazing. I've never been to the Grand Canyon. That's one of my goals. I've never been out west. I want to see that, just stand on the edge and look out over God's beautiful creation. No, we should delight in and enjoy God's creation. We should let it lead us to love Him and to better appreciate Him. He made it, and it reveals Himself to us. So world here cannot mean creation or the universe. The second way that John often uses the word is to refer to humanity, to mankind, the people in the world. But again, this cannot mean what John means here, because as we've already seen, John 3:16 says that God so loved the world, clearly meaning the people in the world. Elsewhere in Scripture, we are commanded over and over again to love people, both Christian and non. In Matthew 5, Jesus says, "You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you." In Galatians 6:10, Paul tells us to do good to everyone. In Titus 3, he tells us to speak evil of no one and to show perfect courtesy towards all people. We are clearly called to love others, even our enemies, even those who would do us harm. So people cannot be what John means here when he says work. So what does he mean? Well, it's the third way that he tends to use this word. World, as John uses it here, means, kind of hard to describe, it means kind of the entire system that is set up against and in opposition to God. If you want to be more clear what John means exactly here, just put the adjective fallen there in front of world. Do not love the fallen world. He means do not love the broken, sin-cursed, wicked world, which is dominated and ruled by Satan. It means the unbelieving, evil world. World here means anything, thoughts or values or behaviors that are contrary to God's word and to God's will. Right, so don't think creation, we are to love creation. Don't think people, we are to love people. Think evil, think wickedness, think sin. That's what we are being told here not to love. If you don't believe me, look at verse 16. Because John specifically defines what he means by world for us. The world, he says, is characterized by these three things: the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, and the pride of life. And I want you to pay attention here, because this is where we often go so wrong. We often define the world as the things out there. Thus, our solution to avoiding worldliness is to keep the things out there from getting in here. But that's not at all how John's describing the world here. That's not how he approaches this. According to him, the problem's not out there. The problem is in here. Or you don't have a stuff problem. You have a heart problem. It starts off with this desire. The King James translates it lust. That's our word that we've talked about a couple of times. Epithumia in the Greek. It means over desire. Desire, good. over-desire bad. Or maybe you could say it's the difference between a desire and a demand. Right, well, let's look at an example. When you read lust, we always instantly think sex. Right? And that's not all it is, but let's start there. Right? Sex is good. God created sex. He designed it for our good to be delighted in and to be enjoyed. He even designed us to desire sex. That's all good. No problem. The problem is when we over-desire it or we demand it, which is when we take a good thing that He has given to us and we make it into an ultimate thing. We make it into a non-negotiable that we have an unlimited right to have on our own terms, however we want it. Well, that's not how things work. God is the author. God created sex and designed it to work in a certain way. He's told us what that way is. Thus, when we go against that, things are going to work out poorly for us. And we have over-desired and sought to fill that desire in an unhealthy way, contrary to God's word and His will. That's the lust of the flesh. It applies to anything, not just sex. It's to be kind of... it's basically to be subject to your passions and your desires. You say, you feel, oh, I need that, and I want that, and you say, oh, okay, I'm going to have that. Right? That's the desire of the flesh. It's kind of judging everything by purely materialistic, physical standards. It's to live your life dominated by your senses, or your impulses, or your passions. It could be food, it could be in luxury, it could be in entertainment, it could be in money, whatever it is. When you have a desire for something, it's when you have a desire for something that you are going to fulfill at all costs. That's the lust of the flesh. But that doesn't sound all that strange to us, does it? Because that's simply how the world operates, right? The world tells us, well, you want something, go and get it. Right? Just be who you are. Do what you want. Just follow your heart. That's what the world is all about these days. That is terrible advice. I don't know about you, but my heart is pretty awful. If I followed what my heart wanted to do all the time, it would be a disaster. Because the Bible tells us that our hearts are desperately sick. It tells us that we are not good, and that the intention of our hearts are only evil continually. The world says, follow your heart, do what you want. The Bible says, don't trust yourself. The desire of the flesh. Then there's the desire of the eyes. Well, what's the difference? Well, we have now moved, I think, from the temptations that come from within to the temptations that come from without. And our hearts are the problem, but our sinful hearts are not helped by the constant bombardment of temptation that we receive through our eyes. And the lustful look at a woman, the greedy gaze at those things that your friends have that you don't. As we live in a world that is dominated by images, and we live in a world that is dominated by marketing and advertising. Listen, these people aren't dumb. Right? They don't advertise basically everything now with almost naked women because they think it's artistically sophisticated or something. No, they do it because they know that it works. Right? They know that we are looking. They know that they are tapping into something that is in all of us. That over-desire for pleasure and for possession and to have and to gain. That desire that we have within ourselves already is simply made worse by all the temptations that come from the outside. And then there's the third thing that characterizes the world. He says the pride of life. Or if you're in the Pew Bible, look down at the footnote at the bottom, the footnote 4. You'll see that it also says it could be translated the pride in possessions. Right? This word kind of means the same thing. It means kind of your things or what you have that make up your life. So pride of life or possessions is like the attitude of someone who refuses to rely on God while boasting in what he has supposedly gained by himself. Remember Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel, he's up on his wall, kind of looking down over his city, he's like, look, that great Babylon that I have created. Right? Well, we're all basically like that. Look at what I have done with this, that. It's always such small, stupid things that we take pride or boast in. But we all have this tendency to claim credit for what we have accomplished without giving any regard to God. Right? That's what John means. These three things are what John means when he is talking about the world. It is this whole system of sin and brokenness. It is basically a focus on self and not on God. It's a rejection of His will and His way to go after our own will and our own way. That is what we are being told not to love. Right? Sin, evil, wickedness, selfishness. That's what John means when he says the world. So make sure and get that in your mind. Which brings us to our second question. We need to know what it means to love this world. Love of the world, as John here defines it, is worldliness. But again, we need to define that word because that's a word that we've always just kind of thrown out. Oh, there's all kinds of worldliness out there. And I think we use it wrong. Again, we've tended to define worldliness according to trivial things like music and movies and dress. But worldliness is not at all trivial. And worldliness is not necessarily about those things. Worldliness is being attached to, engrossed in, or preoccupied with the things of this life now. Worldliness simply means like accepting the values and the practices of the nice but unbelieving people around us and just assuming that those values are biblical. It's simply going along with the culture around us. To think as the world thinks and to value what the world values. It is love for the fallen world. Well, you can say that worldliness, this is a quote that a guy wrote, I forgot to write down who said it, but I really like this. Worldliness, he says, is whatever makes sin look normal and righteousness look strange. I think that's really good. Worldliness is whatever makes sin look normal and righteousness look strange. And guys, this is what's so powerful and so dangerous about entertainment. Entertainment, it wears us down. It desensitizes us. I've seen so much violence in my life as a kid in video games and on TV that I have zero affected by violence. Right? I've been desensitized to violence. Right? What entertainment does is that if we're not actively thinking and engaging and discerning what it is that we're watching, it'll slowly come in and change how we view things without us even being aware that it's happening. That's how the world sucks you in. It's very tricky. And it's very subtle. If you see something enough, eventually that something will become normal to you. Right? The world changes your mind by overwhelming you with its message through all the forms of media that you are constantly taking in. Joe Biden, Vice President, a couple years ago was talking about this is the radical shift our culture has made in its opinions on homosexuality and gay marriage. Like, it's just amazing how quick that has shifted. And he said in this interview that it's not because the activists were so great, it's not because all the philosophers had such brilliant arguments or anything they convinced us, and that's not what changed it. He says the number one factor that made the switch so big and so quick and so smooth was the show Will and Grace. And I think he's right. So what happened there is they finally realized, well, we don't need to just argue and fight and protest. No, like, we're just going to pipe this into your home every single night, and you're going to watch it, and you're going to be overwhelmed with it, and you're going to be flooded with it, and eventually you're going to think, oh yeah, okay, this is normal, right? That's what entertainment and that's what media does. Now listen, if you know me at all, I am not against TV and movies. I really like TV and movies. I will never stand up here and tell you that you cannot watch TV and movies. I watch TV and movies. But I will tell you that you need to be careful. And more careful than I bet that you are. And I will tell you that there are some things that you simply should not watch. We were on the airplane, and Emma likes me, and Lila likes Melissa. And Lila does not like me. Emma likes both of us. I don't know what is going on right now. But she likes her mother. Which was great news for me on the flight, because Lila was just on top of pregnant Melissa the whole time, and I just had to sit there with Emma, and we just both watched the movies the whole time. So I had a wonderful flight. Melissa did not. So I was just kind of flipping, looking through things to watch, just kind of seeing what they had on the little TV. I like flying. And I was flipping through, and there was this special on this new actress that I'd been hearing a lot about, but didn't know much about her. And I knew she was from New York, and she was kind of a big deal. I was like, oh, well, what is it? I'm going to check this out. It was this comedian named Amy Schumer, and I didn't know a whole lot about her. So I flipped it on for a second, and I pretty much immediately had to flip it off. And listen, I'm not a person who is really sensitive to various things, but I flipped it off almost right away because it was so rough. And it was something that I did not need to be watching. It was something that I did not need to be taking in and using as entertainment. It was that bad. Now, does that mean I watched nothing? No, absolutely not. I watched movies. I love movies. I watched was Bridge of Spies. It's a movie starring Tom Hanks, and it's about the Cold War, this prisoner exchange. It was fantastic. You should watch that movie. It was really, really good. So I'm not saying don't watch. I'm saying watch very wisely. And what I am saying is you need to be willing to turn something off. Right? There's a problem when we are entertained by what Scripture calls evil. That's something I'm really wrestling with. What are we laughing at, and what are we entertained by? The Scripture is saying is wickedness, right? So again, don't not watch, but I'm saying watch discerningly, right? Well, what John is saying, you cannot be characterized by worldliness and be a Christian. Do not love the world. And remember that we've talked a lot about love lately. Love is not just affection. It's not just emotional feeling. It's not just, oh, I like something a lot, so I'm going to say love. No, that's not what it is. To love is to serve. To love is to seek the good of the loved. So then, likewise, to love the world is to serve the world. It is to seek and to affirm what the world affirms as good and important. You see that the world says that beauty and pleasure and money and comfort and self-fulfillment are what life is all about, so you then make your life about pursuing those things. That's loving the world. It's simply living for what the world lives for. It's simply being like everyone else around you, which may not at first seem like that much of a problem. So why is loving the world such a problem? What's so bad about it? Well, John gives us, I think, three reasons. Two are very specific, and one, I think, is implied. He says loving the world is bad, it's stupid, even, because the world does not last, because the world does not satisfy, and because love for the world means that you do not know God. First, it is dumb to love the world because the world does not last. Verse 17, and the world is passing away along with its desires. We'll talk about this more next week. In verse 18, you'll see there that John says that it is the last hour. We'll figure out what he means by that. So we'll come back to that. But what he's saying here is that it's dumb to love the world because the world is temporary. It is fleeting. You are loving something. You are building your life around something. You are living for something that is dying. And loving the world, I'm trying to be a grown-up. I'm 31, I have kids, and I'm a pastor of the church, so I think I should be a grown-up. Maybe that's what the beard's about. But I figured, all right, I'm supposed to start saving money. We've never had money before, so we're trying to save a little bit of money. I had to open an IRA, and I just thought you'd save money and something magically happens. No, like, an IRA, you have to take it, you have to invest it. You have to choose, like, the mutual funds and the stocks and whatever it is. You're putting that money in so that it'll grow so you can have more in the future. Investing, so hopefully I'm doing something correct. But loving the world would be like me taking all that money that I'm trying to save, not all that money, but that money that I'm trying to save and investing it in a company that I know is going to close the stores tomorrow. Right? It's just pouring my money and dumping it into something that I know will utterly disappear tomorrow. Right? No one buys a beachfront house that is inches from being destroyed by the waves. But that is exactly what you're doing by investing into the world. You're pouring everything that you have and everything that you are into a sinking ship. Right? People got on the Titanic because it was supposed to be the most luxurious and the most safe ship in the world. And people got off the Titanic because it was sinking. Right? No one who wasn't on it at that time was thinking as the ship was going down, man, it was the biggest ship and it was really nice and supposed to be safe. I'd really like to get on that thing. No, it was dying. And so is this world. Thus, to invest yourself into a dying world is simple stupidity. Guys, we work, and we earn, and we build, and we hoard, and we stress, and we achieve, and we gain, and we die. Having accomplished what? None of it goes with us. I've never been to Egypt. That's on my list. I'd love to go to Egypt. I'd really like to see the pyramids. The pyramids are really, really cool looking. Right? They're big, massive, ornate tombs filled with great riches for who were the most powerful men in the world at that time. They're amazing, but they are stupid. The pyramids were stupid, rich, powerful men trying to hold on to that which they could not hold on to. Now these guys are bones. They're museums, this place. Go to the Met and you can see these guys. See how that tomb worked out and all the riches worked out for them. Display in a museum. All that work for nothing. The world is passing away. Not the physical creation, but the system of sin that is opposed to God. Quit wasting your time with it and invest in what matters. Guys, if all this is true, this whole Jesus thing and this whole gospel thing, if you are really more than just an animal, more than just a physical body that lives for 80 years and it is no more, if you are truly a person, a soul of inestimable value and eternal duration,
than to obsess over these 80 years while paying no regard to the eternity of 80 years that is to follow is the height of foolishness. This is stupid. The world is dying, so stop loving it. Second, loving the world is bad because the world does not satisfy. It cannot deliver on what it promises. It's NFL playoff season. We started last night. Jet lagged, and I needed to go to bed, but man, the end of that game was really, really good. So I stayed up a little bit too late. And so I'm exhausted now, so I hope to fall asleep in front of some football today. But Tom Brady, who is going to go down as the greatest quarterback of all time, it's done, it's no longer a conversation. He's the best. He's got 4 Super Bowl rings. He's about to be playing for a 5th Super Bowl ring. He's got everything. He's got money. He's got a supermodel wife. He's got cute kids. He's got fame. He's got success. He has everything. We had a really famous interview after winning his 3rd Super Bowl on 60 Minutes a couple years ago. Here's what Tom Brady, who has everything, said after being at the top of his career. He says, "Why do I have 3 Super Bowl rings and still think that there's something greater out there for me? I mean, maybe a lot of people would say this is what it's all about. I reached my goal, my dream, my life, but me, I think, God, it has got to be more than this. I mean, this can't be all it's cracked up to be. What's the answer? I wish I knew." And so there's Tom Brady after winning the Super Bowl with everything and saying, man, it wasn't enough. It didn't really deliver. Nothing's really different. I saw an interview with him recently where he was talking about that interview. He says after that interview, he got like hundreds of Bibles in the mail. But here, let us tell you, let us show you. So he didn't have some great conversion moment or anything. But he felt the restlessness, and he felt the dissatisfaction of the world. Right? Take it from a guy who has been there, who has achieved everything that he could have imagined. That thing that you are daydreaming about. Right? There's something that you're daydreaming about. I don't know what it is. I can't read your mind. But I know that there's something that you are thinking about right before, or now it's coming into your mind right now. You're thinking, that's the thing. Right? Once I get that thing, everything will be different. Everything will be better. Then I will be set. If I can just get this job, if I can just make this much money, if I can just move out of this darn city, if I can just win the lottery, like the biggest one ever right now, if I can just win that lottery, whatever that thing is that's in your mind that you think you need, or that you're going to get, and that's going to change everything, it will not do what you think it will do. Nothing will be different. After a year, or a month, or even a few days, you will be right back where you were, and maybe even worse off. Tom Brady has had and done everything you could possibly dream of, and none of it has provided him with the satisfaction that he was looking for. Why is that? Why doesn't the world satisfy you? Because it can't. It was never designed to satisfy you. You were specifically designed to be fully satisfied by one thing. That is God Himself, the creator of the universe. Ecclesiastes 3:11 says that God has placed eternity into your heart. That's why the things that are passing away cannot satisfy that desire, that eternal longing that you have. As Augustine famously said, our hearts are restless, Lord, until they find their rest in you. Have you felt that restlessness? Have you experienced that dissatisfaction with life? That feeling that nothing seems to quite deliver? You get that thing that was supposed to satisfy, and then it's just disappointment. It's become kind of cliche now for pastors. They say the only thing worse than God not giving you exactly what you wanted is God giving you exactly what you wanted. Because it never does what you thought it would. All your kids, 2 weeks after Christmas, 3 weeks after Christmas, all of your kids are already over and tired of their Christmas presents, right? They don't even care about them anymore. They're old hat, right? And listen, we're no better as adults. The world does not satisfy. But why? Why do you keep trying to make it? The world is passing away. It does not satisfy. There is little else to offer. And the most important thing he says in the third is that it's bad to love the world, because if you love the world, then you do not love God, and you do not know Him. And worse, He does not love you, since the love of the Father is not in you. Guys, it's one or the other. You cannot love both. You cannot play both sides. Listen, it's really common sense. You cannot love both God and love that which is opposed to God. You cannot both live for God and live for that which God hates.
on Thursday, I was a bad husband. I dumped the kids on Melissa for a couple hours. A few museums I wanted to do. I wanted to go to Westminster and sit in an evening song and be in the cathedral. One of the museums I'd never done that I went to on Thursday was the Winston Churchill War Rooms. Right? So Winston Churchill, if you want to feel bad about yourself, go read about Winston Churchill. He was maybe the most impressive man to live in the 20th century. Go read some of his biographies. He was the Prime Minister of England in World War II. Right? And so you have England. It's a lot closer to Germany than you think. So in the middle of the war, at the beginning, before the U.S. entered, it looked like Britain would lose, because Germans every night was flying planes over there and dropping bombs and bombing the beautiful city. So what they had to do was put the government underground, under this building close to Buckingham Palace, these underground bunkers that they preserved exactly like they were. So we just went and spent 2 hours kind of checking that out. It was really, really neat. But in World War II, you could not fight for both the Allies and the Axis. You could not fight for Britain and the U.S. and Germany, because they were two directly opposed to each other. They were living and fighting for two exactly opposite things. You could not serve Hitler and Churchill at the same time. In the same way, you cannot serve God and serve the world at the same time. You cannot love God and the world at the same time. One cannot be a Christian if one habitually and continually and time after time invests his or her time, effort, and energy in the things of the world and in the things that are hostile to Christ and the gospel. So it's that simple. So as George Thorogood sang back in 1979, who do you love? Who do you love? That's the question. Here's a couple of questions I want you to jot down quickly and take them home and pray through these tonight. Think through them tonight. Or if you do your time in the Word in the morning, take them tomorrow morning and just kind of sit and dwell on these questions for a second. Number one, does outward prosperity appeal to you more than growth in godliness? And answer, it's easy to say no. Okay, answer the questions. Honestly, I love the old hymn we sang, I'd rather have Jesus. Like, would you rather have him than silver or gold? Well, we don't talk about silver. Billions of dollars, right? Here's billions of dollars, or here's Jesus, right? How would you choose? Number two, do you crave the approval of those around you, even non-Christians? Have you ever felt that and wondered, why do I do this? Why am I so concerned about having their approval? Number three, related to that one. Do you go to great lengths to avoid looking foolish or being rejected for your Christian faith? That was convicting to me. I want to look intelligent and reasonable and logical, and I have great, really answers for everything. But Paul says that the cross is foolishness to those who are imperishing. It doesn't make any sense. I'm reading a book right now called Fool's Talk. It's really, really good. Basically, he's arguing in the books. And listen, this message doesn't make sense to the world. We've got to be willing to be the jester. We've got to be willing to speak truth, even when the world says, hey, you're idiots, you're fools. This doesn't make any sense. Right? Do you go to great lengths to avoid looking foolish or being rejected for your Christian faith? Why? Why is that? Why do you care? Number four, do you consider present and material results more important than eternal reward? Again, it's easy to say no, but what are you investing your time? What are you investing your money? What are you thinking about and obsessing over? Is it something here and now and of the world, or is it something bigger and eternal and of God's kingdom? And number five, just kind of summing up the rest of them, would you say that you're living for God or for self? Do you live to please Him or yourself? I always use an example. I was single until I was 25, so I had three years after college where I was living by myself with a bunch of guys, and everything that I did was for me. I'm going to do this. I don't want to do anything. I'm going to give you another job. I'm going to play video games. I just did what I wanted for me. Then I got married. And all of a sudden that started to change. Right? Slowly, it should have changed quicker. But all of a sudden now there's this other person that I am now responsible to think for and to take into consideration and to make choices with. And then there's these two kids, and there's a third one coming. Now, all of a sudden, what I want doesn't really matter. But that's how it should be. No, my job is to live and to act and to choose and to work for them. And I now live to serve them. My attitudes and opinions and desires are secondary. I am for them. That's what love is. It's service of the other. Well, would you say that you're living for yourself or that you're living for God? And that's an answer, honestly. Because John says that if you love
the world, then you do not love God, or that you do not know God. So if you do find yourself loving the world, if you're like me, if you're like all of us in here, and you find yourself sometime drawn to the world and attracted to the world more than you know that you should be, what do you do? How do you stop loving the world? Well, the bad news is that you can't just stop loving the world. You can't just stop loving something that has such a powerful hold on you. That's not how love works. The fundamentalist solution has always been separation. Right? Separation is big in those circles. You cut yourself off from anything that could potentially be bad. Right? That's why you don't do this, you don't do that, no movies, no TV, no these things. You keep all the bad stuff out, and then you'll be okay. I don't remember who said it, but someone said, like, the only problem with a monastery is you build up all these walls, and you wall the world out, and you've got this closed, safe area, but all that falls apart once you put people inside of it, right? Because then you bring the world in, right? Because we are the problem. Our problem is sin. It is not stuff. The world isn't the main problem. Our heart is the main problem. We look outside of ourselves. John is taking us inside of ourselves. The fundamental solution of just always just separate yourself from these things doesn't work. 400 years ago, Martin Luther argued that if we insist on doing away with and destroying everything that condemned us to sin, well, then we might as well go ahead and kill ourselves, because our hearts can twist anything into sin or temptation. Paul says in Colossians 2, verse 20, "Why do you submit to the regulations, do not handle, or do not taste, or do not touch, according to human precepts and teaching? These have an appearance of wisdom in promoting self-made religion, but they are of no value in stopping the indulgence of the flesh." So all the rules and all the regulations and all the do not do this, do not, he says it has no value in stopping the flesh. So what is of value in stopping the indulgence of the flesh? How do we not love the world? Well, the only antidote to love for the world is a superior love for the Father. As rules and regulations will not do it, only a superior love will. As Thomas Chalmers so famously wrote many years ago, what you need is the expulsive power of a new affection. Google that phrase and go read his sermon. The expulsive power of a new affection. Expulsive. So this new affection drives out the old affection. It forces it out. Yes, this world is passing away. Yes, it cannot satisfy. But me just standing here and telling you that will not accomplish that much. What you need is something better to love. What you need is to be attracted and drawn to the one who will never pass away and who will always satisfy you completely. What you need is to see the beauty and the superiority of Jesus Christ. Your only hope is to develop a superior love for Him that will then crowd out all those inferior loves, including love for the world. And that only comes from repeated exposure to the gospel through God's Word. That only comes as you begin to grasp the love and the grace and the mercy of Jesus Christ. That you were dead in your trespasses and sins. That you deserve nothing but hell and suffering for that sin. But that Christ loved you and died for you. That He took your place. That though you loved the world, He loved you. And He loved the Father. And thus He willingly sacrificed Himself so that you could live. This is the ultimate act of love and service. Your only hope to not love the world is to know this, and to not just know this, but to delight in this. And the only place that you can do that is in His Word. Guys, listen, I know you don't read the Word. I'm not a mind reader. It's just statistics, and I've been there. But listen, I really want to challenge you as we begin the new year. Make this year the year that you take seriously your relationship, or maybe your lack of relationship, with the Lord. Remember that the world wins you through its media. It changes your mind and it overwhelms your thinking by constantly bombarding you with its message, and eventually that message will influence you and it will take over. The only way to counter that is through God's media. You want a new affection? You want a changed mind? You want to see and understand this? Then you need the Word. Listen, I don't care if it's hard. I don't care if it's confusing. I don't care if it at first feels like a chore or if you're not having any magical emotional responses. Commit to reading it and reading it and reading it. And I guarantee you that if you do that and you actually stick with it, things will change. The voice of the world will slowly be crowded out by the voice of God. Your love for the world will slowly be crowded out by the love of God. There was a Gospel Coalition, it's a great website that you should use and read. A guy wrote an article at Christmas, and I've been reading it and kind of dwelling on it. And his argument that is, if you want to change the mind, and if you want this new affection, there is one magic secret. And he will tell you this secret because he knows that you won't do it. He says, if you take God's Word, and you take every book of the Bible, and you read through each book of the Bible 10 times, it guarantees you that you will have this new changed mind and this new affection. And listen, I'm telling you that it will work. I'm working through it right now. Take a book like 1 John, which you can read in about 15 minutes, and you just read it over and over and over again. You can take it in 2 weeks, you can read that 10 times, and I guarantee you there will be a difference. And I have no problem guaranteeing that to you, because I know that none of you are going to do it. Right? But listen, I'm telling you, if you take that word, and if you commit to reading it over and over and over again, it will work. God has promised that His word will not return void. It won't. That's a promise. So if you want it, and if you want that fruit, and you want that life, and you want that change, then you've got to commit to reading it. It's not going to happen unless you do that. All right, my challenge to you is find a short book like this. Find Ephesians. Ephesians is brilliant, and you can read it in a couple minutes. And just take, I'm going to take 20 minutes. I don't care if you read slow, maybe 25. And you just, I'm going to read it one day. And I'm going to read it the next day. And I'm going to read it the next day. On the fifth or the sixth day, you're like, what am I doing? I'm hitting a wall. This isn't doing anything. But I'm telling you, push through and keep reading. It will not return void. You cannot love that which you do not know. And I bet you know the world very, very well. My challenge is that you make a real concerted effort to get to know God just as well. I'm telling you, the love and the affection will follow. Get the book that I mentioned a few weeks ago, Janet Packer's Knowing God. Elaine got it. She hasn't even been able to read it yet because Gabby picked it up. And Gabby's been reading it. Perfect. That's exactly what I want to happen. Read that book. And more importantly, read God's Word. Commit. Start with Ephesians. Do 1 John. Read through the Gospel of John. Drown yourself in the Word. In the Word. And watch the world start to be drowned out by it. Do not love the Word. It does not satisfy, it does not last, and it keeps you from God's love. His love lasts forever, and it is completely satisfying. Who do you love? Bow with me, let's close in a word of prayer. Father, thank you for your word, and thank you for bringing us home. Thank you for my brothers and sisters. I love them very much. They are loved. I pray that they know that they are loved by you. I pray that you would just fill them with a great affection for your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, forgive us for how drawn to the world we all are. Forgive us for how quickly we are distracted by things that are passing away, by things that cannot satisfy us. Father, we need your Spirit to show us. Father, let us taste and see that you are good. I pray that we would know that and experience that. We would be able to share that love for you with one another and share that with the world around us. So Father, can you convict us where we have gone wrong in this area? Father, convict us of where the world has crept in and where we are drawn and attracted and love it, Father, and pull us away from that love. And do it by just magnifying the goodness and the beauty and the grace and the mercy of your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, that we would see Him supremely desired, that desire would crowd out every other inferior desire. Father, my words cannot accomplish anything. I know that you, and I know that you work through your word. So Father, I pray that you would drive us to it, that you would make us commit to it. You would grant us grace and mercy to discipline ourselves to read your word, Father. And we claim the promise that your word will not return to you. You will work in us and us personally and us corporately as a church. We need you. We need your Spirit. Thank you for your Son, Jesus. And we pray this in the